This
good time.
conference will now be recorded.
So, Naresh, are you there? I can see you are in your street over there.
Yes, we can start.
Okay. So, Naresh, have you seen the last class recording?
I have just gone through that recording, but I haven't seen completely. So, I will see once I'm done with this session.
Okay, so can I know your technical background?
No, actually, I don't have any technical background. I'm working as a recruiter. I know what are different technologies, but I don't know what insights. I don't know the insights.
Okay, so have you done your engineering in computer science, or do you have any idea about the scripting side of it? Any tool, not service, not any technical tool?
Yes, actually, I have undergone Java scripting class, and I did some UI development, and that is where I have used JavaScript.
Okay, perfect. So you're trying to move towards service now?
Yes.
So
it was just a one and a half month experience.
Okay, so you're trying to move in development of service now, that's what you're looking for?
Yeah.
Okay, perfect.
Hello.
Yeah, I can hear you. Okay, perfect.
Okay.
Guys, may I know who has joined us, caller 02 and caller 01?
Well, one line is mine, Saloni. This is Rahul.
Mm-hmm. Caller 01, may I know who are you? Caller 01, are you there? I'm dismissing you. Please try to rejoin because you're not audible. Caller 01. Guys, let's wait a minute. I think we dropped someone. Just 1 minute, we'll wait and then we'll start.
This conference will now be recorded.
So far, I think we have seen till the history of the tool, correct? We started with the incident application, guys. Vinisha, am I correct? Or Rahul, am I correct on that?
Yes.
Okay, Vinisha is right? Vinisha is
there? Vinisha is also there. Yeah.
Okay, take care. Okay. So let's start with the incident application. So just overview for you, Naresh. Incident is nothing but whenever employees are facing certain issue, whenever employees need any kind of technical help, in such particular case, an employee creates an incident into the ServiceNow ticketing tool. An employee goes ahead, an issue can be, let's say my laptop is not working, an issue can be, suppose I had printer access and today I'm not able to print any documents. So any kind of service which was there already available to the customer, to the end user, and today all of a sudden it has stopped working. In such particular case, a customer will report something called an incident. Okay, so let's just check it out. Let's just see how does it work. So for that too, we started in the last class to create an incident. I typed this incident in the left hand side, and then I had started with creating it. And that some basic fields we had seen till your this set of fields we had done, and we were there somewhere on opened and opened by, correct? So I was talking about the opened by and opened. These are the two set of fields which get auto-populated. You are not populating the data in those fields. These are getting auto-calculated. So the first field over here is opened by, means the person who is trying to create the ticket, the person who has clicked on, in this particular case, the create new, his or her name is getting populated in the opened by. And what is that magnifying glass signifying over there? Can Vinisha, you and Rahul help Naresh to understand that? What is the use of the magnifying glass over there? Rahul, you want to give it a try?
Yes. Hold on. Vinisha was responding. Yeah.
Okay, it's a reference field. So we have a list of values already there in the database or like system. So we are able to only select those fields, not the new fields. So if, for example, if we are giving a name, the caller's name or something, so we will be only able to pick up what is available in the list. Other than that, we will not be able to pick up.
So can I say at any given point in time, and what type of field it is called? Do you remember the type of the field?
Reference field.
Correct. It is called a reference field because it is pulling the data from some other given table over here. So the behavior of reference field is nothing but the behavior of reference field is it will pick up the data from certain given table. So when I say so over here in this case of the pin by, as you said, we are doing the selection of the data into the system perspective. That is at any given point in time over here in this case, how does it work? At any given point in time over here in this case, we are selecting who is the open by over here. That is anytime if a field is having a magnifying glass, field type is reference. And in such particular field, you can't type in a string field data. It is not a regular string field. Rather, in any reference field, selection of the data happens. But obviously over here in this case, because it was getting auto-populated, so ServiceNow itself has done the selection for you. It is not exposing its selection option over there for you in this case. So open by and open, these are the two fields, as I told you, getting auto-populated based by the system. You can't, because right now I'm logged in as a super user, system administrator means what? I have got full access inside the tool. I'm acting as admin right now. So that's why for me, these fields are in a table. But in a real point in time, for the end user perspective, if we check it out, if we try to understand, an end user will never be able to select or alter the data. Okay? Okay. So these fields will be auto-populated and these will be read-only for the end user's perspective. So now proceeding further, knowledge we'll talk about later, guys. Contact type. So let me first select a caller. Let's say suppose, for example, if the caller is able to term. Contact type is nothing but we are asking the end user, that is the caller. Actually, caller is the person facing the issue. So we are asking caller to provide his best way of communication, his preferred mode of communication with the technician. So by this contact type, let's say, for example, if he selects email over here, means the caller is saying that, okay, he would prefer to contact the technician via the email mode. But it does not mean that the technician can't contact him via other mode. It is just setting a preference over here. But at the same time, you are not making any decision over there. You can't force the decision. You are just giving the option over there, saying that, okay, I would prefer if the technician contacts me via email. Instead, let it be a new incident over here in this case. Let's not work about that. Next is assignment group and assigned. What can be the use of assignment group, guys? What can be the purpose you can think about? How will we use assignment group? Anyone?
Assignment group is the target team to which the ticket has been assigned.
So at any particular point in time, which team will be working on your ticket, you will be selecting that over there in the assignment group. Now, is it necessary for an end user to know to which team it should be assigned to which team the ticket should be assigned to? If I'm an end user, is it necessary for me to know the team name?
No,
not needed.
Correct, not required. So yeah, if he knows, obviously good for you. But at the same time, I can't force him to know the name, correct?
Yeah.
So let's try to understand how does it work over here in this case. So at any particular point in time, whenever we have to do this configuration, we need to understand, let's say if end user does not know which team is going to work and these two fields, and within that team, which person is going to work, I am going to keep those empty. I'm going to submit my record. So by this, we have seen the other set of fields over here, and I'm just going to do the submission of this. Let me just copy the incident number and try to submit the record. Whenever you do the submission of the record, guys, you can see system is directing to you to a page where a list of similar records are located. So over here, obviously, you can search for other incidents too, plus your two. Let's say I'm going to look for my incident. I'm going to search for that number. In the number, I'm pasting the number and pressing enter. So the system returns with the same record number. So I'm going to look for it. What happened at this particular point in time? So we can see in the database, this record has been inserted. And now what will happen whenever an incident is created by end user, because end user has not populated the group. So now who will come into picture to do the group assignment? Because obviously a team, a group will be working on the ticket. In this particular case, when the group selection is empty, obviously no one can be responsible for working on the ticket. So for that particular reasoning, in your organization, there will be a support team whose work will be to check the short description. Let me say, I'm just giving something that we are away. The support team work will be to go over here, check the category and the subcategory, and again, based on that, check the short description. And this support team is not a specific technician and specific to a department. Rather, their work is to what? Rather, their work is to based on the priority and based on the category, subcategory. This support team will do the assignment of the ticket to valid group. So they will have a sheet or they will have a detail that is how the mapping works. So that is so-and-so kind of ticket should go to so-and-so team. Some kind of mapping sheet they'll have. And based on that, they'll go ahead and pick up the correct assignment group. Now let's see. Assignment group again has a magnifying glass, means this one is pulling data from another table. Let's check it out. So if I click on the magnifying glass, you can see it says over here on the top, group hierarchy, means this one is pulling the data from the group table over here. Okay, so whichever group you want the ticket to be assigned to, yes, you can make the selection. Let's say just a scenario over here, guys, just to show it to you, how does it work? Suppose I want it to be assigned to the software team. So the support team knows which team has to work on the ticket. He or she is going to make the selection of that and update it. State is still new, state has still not changed. And again, the person, let's say, opens the ticket now. This time, when the support team assigns the ticket, what will happen? The moment support team populates the assignment group, then and there, email will be triggered to the team of this particular case. In this particular case, for example, the moment ticket is assigned to the software team, email will be triggered to the software team members, so that they are aware that, okay, so-and-so ticket has come to the queue for working on. Then what will happen? Then one of the team members will assign the ticket to themselves, or the manager of that team will assign the ticket to someone, asking them to work or asking them to look into. Okay. So one thing to understand over here in this case is that now, at any given point in time, what will be assigned to? Let's try to say that. So if I wipe it off, when I click on the assigned to, you can see it is only showing you 9 users, but that is, it is pulling up the data from the user table, but 9 data only to show. In the case of call it, this was also pulling the data from user, but it has 798 users over here. So can any one of you help me in understanding why over here in the assigned to only 9 users, as was in why only limited set of users are getting displayed over here, not all the users from the user table?
Maybe it's because of the assigned group does have only 9 users.
Correct, you are. That is, at any given point in time, whenever you are doing the selection of the user, in your assigned to says I'm only going to show you those users which belong to the selected assignment group. So as we had selected the assignment group as software, so whosoever is member of that group, that is getting displayed to you, not all the users. Okay.
Yes.
Now let's proceed further. Let's see the next configuration over here. So the next thing which we need to understand is, let's say suppose I select one of the users saying that, okay, this user is going to work on the ticket. Now, initially the ticket state will be new. But the moment you populate the assign to and save the data, for me, I had a script doing that. So that's why I became active. But at any particular point in time, whenever someone manually or through script, what are the process maybe, the moment assigned to field gets populated in the incident table, that time state itself gets changed from new to active. Why does it get changed to active? What does our active symbolize, guys? Initially, incident was created in the state new. Now, the moment I'm saying the assigned to field gets populated with a technician, assigned to field, not the group, assigned to field gets populated with a technician's name, then and there you can see the state of the incident got changed to active. What can that symbolize over here? What idea do we get from that? Anyone? When changed to active, what do we understand from that? When changes to active, the understanding which we get from there is looks like initially it was new, means a new ticket has been created, but no one still has been assigned the responsibility of working on the ticket. So the moment assigned to is populated means what? The moment assigned to is populated means now someone is responsible for working on the ticket. So if a person is responsible for working on the ticket in that particular case, what happens? The moment it does happen like that, then and there what happens is then and there, we need to go ahead in the instance perspective, and the system has been designed such a way that we have commanded the service not to do that. That is, the moment the assigned to is populated means now, can I say this particular person is responsible for working on the issue? Correct? Now that person is accountable for the issue. Correct? For that particular reasoning, we are changing the state of the ticket to active. Are we making sense?
Yes.
So that's yes. The reasoning because of which what has happened over here, that's the reasoning because of which over here in this particular one up, the state has automatically been changed to your assigned over here. Okay. So now let's try to proceed further, guys. Let's try to see the next configuration over here. The next thing is what? Let's try to see some other type of fields within the service. Now, so for that, I'm going to pick up now these two set of fields, the highlighted one which I'm highlighting right now. That is, let's understand work notes and additional comments over here. So the first thing first which I'm going to do is let me enter, suppose, any kind of data just to show you what happens. At any particular point in time, before I proceed further, guys, if you click on update, what is happening is you click on update, it takes you to the list view of the record, correct? It takes you to the page. This page is called list view of your table, or in this case, the incident table list view it is called, because this view is capable enough of showing you multiple records. That is, if I remove this filter, obviously, if I put it, let's say, active equal to true. So obviously, right now, this view can show you n number of records. That is, as per the filter applied, this view is capable enough of showing you multiple data, multiple records. So that's why this view's name is what? That's why this view is called as your list view. Okay. So if I open the incident back, let's check it out. Where did the data of that W1 and A1 went? So if you can see, of your surprise, these fields are not holding the data any longer. Can you see somewhere W1 and A1? Let's check it out that. You can see instead it has been passed on to the activity A1 and W1. What benefit can we get from here? Can you guess about it? If I'm doing the configuration like this, if the field is not retaining the data, rather it is passing it on, how does it work?
Saloni, can you repeat the question once again?
Yeah. So my question over here in this case is, these fields, if you check it out over here, these fields are retaining the data over here.
Retaining the data A1, W1, is that what?
How is it retaining the data? It is not keeping the data inside itself like a regular string field. Like, whatever we typed in short description is still in short description field getting displayed over here.
Right.
Correct?
Mm-hmm.
So now what do we need to understand over here in this case is that whenever we are doing the configuration, why are these two fields, instead of keeping the data inside themselves, they are passing it on to the activity, correct? You can see I entered in workloads W1, it came over here. Additional comment right. A1, I entered, it came over here.
Mm-hmm. It looks like the activities comments, the comments in the activities section represent the history of the ticket, like whatever notes was entered or like whatever comments were entered in the process of working on the ticket are kept as history in the activity session. Is that correct?
What the benefit are you getting? As in, it is passing it on to activity, agree on that. So why it has been structured like that? What benefit will you get with a field of similar behavior?
It just adds additional information, and the timestamp information will be helpful in seeing what updates happen for the ticket. I would like to hear it from you, right? So that was a guess.
Okay.
Hello.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Maybe work notes for internal purpose and additional comments for visible to the user.
I agree on that. But that is one part of the understanding. We'll discuss that too. But before that, what we wanted to talk about over here in this case, so is that at any given point in time, whenever I'm doing this, let's keep the behavior as let's keep the technical use of these fields apart. But what I was expecting or I want to know over here is that what benefit if you get out of these fields, as in why are these fields structured in such a way that they don't retain the data in themselves, rather pass on to the activity? So what benefit will you get out of that? Any idea, any thing which you can guess about that one? So the benefit of these fields are, guys, these are used for what? These are used for integration purpose.
So apart from having just a work notes type of nature to them, they also have an integration purpose attached to them.
As in? I didn't get it.
Okay. So my assumption was this activity session will just have comments kind of, it will just keep track of the comments that were entered as work notes.
So can but I was, say, just to reiterate your statement here, you're correct on that. That is, the benefit of these two fields are that these two fields are not a regular string field. If they could have been a regular string field, so let's say, for example, at this point in time, me and Vinisha, we are trying to interact. Maybe I'm the caller, just a scenario. And suppose Vinisha is the technician over here. So in this case, if it could have been a regular string field, whosoever would have entered the data last, only that person's info we would have been able to see. So let's say, suppose in the work notes, just a scenario, guys, I entered A, and then Vinisha entered B. So the moment she enters B, she overwrites A to B. Obviously, what was entered by me, that was a data keyword A, that is totally lost. We can't see what was entered by me, what is the history of the communication, correct? So for that particular reasoning, these two fields have been structured in such a way that it says that, okay, these two fields will provide interaction, whatever people have done, their history will be stored in the activity. That is, whenever anyone enters the data in any of these fields, these get stored, as you can see in the activity section. So the benefit of that over here will be people can use these set of fields for what? People can use both the set of fields for the interaction purposes.
Okay.
Make sense?
Yep.
Okay.
Saloni, so can you repeat it, please?
Hmm? So what I'm saying over here in this case is, at any given point in time, we are doing the setup in such a way, we are using these two fields. If you can see, these fields didn't retain the data, correct? Whatever I typed in, they got passed on to the activity. So if other person again enters the data in these fields, even that will get passed on to the activity. So means whosoever, so if you can see the benefit of activity, when it gets passed on to activity, for example, let's talk about A1. It says who entered the data, in which field it was entered, what timestamp it was entered, and again, obviously, what comment was entered. So but the benefit of these are that whenever I'm typing in the data in any of these fields, what data has been typed on and by whom is getting recorded in activity. Do you agree on that?
Yes.
Because it is getting recorded in the activity, so obviously it can be used for what? It can be used for future tracking. That is, let's say for today, if I want to know what communication happened yesterday by end user, by technician, whatever the case may be, what info did they shared, I can easily see the info over here.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
That's what I'm saying. These two fields can be used for an interaction purpose. People can interact with reference to these two fields over here.
Okay, got it.
Okay. So when I say so, okay, both the fields look similar with the similar behavior. Yes, one of you were correct on that. That is, what is the difference between the two fields now if I talk about? The difference between the two fields is, as the name says, additional comment means customer visible. What does that mean? Means whatever data is entered in the additional comments, that data will be viewed by customer. When I say customer, means in this case, the caller. So whatever interaction happens via additional comments, as in, let's say me as a technician, if I enter anything and additional comments, if a caller enters anything added in the additional comments, so it is viewable obviously by the technician. Technician can see everything in the record, correct? So that he can or she can look into the ticket and help you out. I'm talking about the customer means the caller right now. That is, whatever is entered in the additional comment. In this case, I had entered A1 in the additional comment that went here. So whatever data has been entered in the additional comments field, that part of the data in the activity will be even visible to your caller. This one was entered in the work notes field. The comment entered in the work notes field plus the field itself is only for the technicians to interact. So when a technician needs to interact within their team, then they will be making use of the work notes field. Let's say if I'm the silent group manager, I want to interact with my juniors. How is it working and stuff like that. So in this particular case, how do we need to work? In this particular case, we need to go ahead in the instance perspective and make use of what? Make use of the configuration. Call your work notes. Technicians to interact, work notes. Again, what has been entered will not be customer visible because technician may need to talk something technical. Even if I, let's say, for example, I'm a Java developer, me and let's say, maybe over here in this case, Naresh, me and Naresh, we are technical team and we want to interact with whatever reasoning it may be. So in this case, if I say, okay, Naresh, line number 3 of the code is not working. If I expose this to customer will panic. Okay, what is that line number 3? What are they discussing? So that's why, to be on a safer side, we are saying whatever has been entered in the work notes plus the work notes field itself will not be customer visible. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So now let's check it out. Let's see how does it work. Okay. So the next thing we need to understand is over here is what? The next thing which we need to understand is what is the type of this field called? I told you the behavior. So one second. So the type of work notes and additional comment field is called journal. So till now, what all we have seen? Till now, we have seen not string field, obviously, that does not have any new thing to bring it on the table. So these are the two new type of fields which we have seen it over here. Are we making sense till here?
Yes. Yep.
Okay. So now let's check it out. Let's see how does it work. So the next thing which we need to understand over here is, at any given point in time, whenever we are doing the setup, whenever we are doing the configuration, journal field gives you the behavior of customer interaction. So tomorrow, if in your table also you want to create such field, this is the type of one. Okay. So now let's proceed further. Let's check it out the next. Next over here are these two fields, watch list and work notes list. So now let's first understand within ServiceNow, what is the type of this field? How does it work? And then I'll talk about the technical aspect of the same. So first I'm going over here in this case and going to talk about the next configuration over here. So the next thing which I want to talk about, how to enter the data. So click on the lock. You can see magnifying glass. Select one of the user, but the benefit, if you see this one, is still I'm getting the magnifying glass option. That is, I can make multiple reference selection over here in the watch list, but in a regular reference field, I can only make a single selection. So do we understand the difference over here?
Yeah.
So what we need to understand over here in this particular one up is, we need to understand over here in this given case is that at any given point in time, when we are doing the setup over here, when we are doing the configuration over here, a reference field will let you select one data. But watch list type of field, the technical term for that type of field is, it is called the list field. The type of the field is list. So list field says it gives you the benefit of a reference. Plus on top of that, it says you that I'm going to make you select multiple references over here. So both the fields are of similar kind. Here also you can see the same behavior, correct? But what is the technical difference between the two is, whosoever's name, now or before that, let me talk about why was this field structured. So let's say over here in this case, suppose for example, maybe Vinisha, let's say your laptop was crashed. So you were recording, you were creating a record over here in this case. Okay, so you were trying to report an incident because maybe let's say your laptop has crashed or whatever the issue may be. So in this case, obviously you're not able to create a ticket on your behalf because you don't have your laptop working. So in that case, let's say you gave a call to the help desk to create a ticket on your behalf and they did create it. So whenever a ticket is created, whenever incident is created, obviously the team to whom it is assigned, all the team members will be able to see, irrespective of who is working on the ticket. Even other members of this team is right now able to see the ticket. Plus, caller will be able to see the ticket, plus OpenY will be able to see the ticket. Do you agree till here, guys? I'll repeat, assignment group, all the members, caller and OpenY. These are the three set of people who will be able to see the data over here in this case.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So now let's check it out. Let's see how does it work over here in this case. So once we are doing the configuration over here in this case, in this situation, Vinisha is caller, opened by is some dummy service desk person, and assignment group is a team who is working on. Now Vinisha, let's say it has been 2-3 days and now you are not getting the resolution, you didn't get any technician call or whatever the case may be. So you want to view your incident to check it out, what is the comment entered by your technician. Do you need to provide some more info? How is the technician proceeding ahead and stuff like that? Will you be able to see your ticket at this point in time? No, you will not be. Because you only told your system is crashed. So obviously you are not going to able to view the incident. In this case, you may need, you will be more happy if your colleague, your manager, someone is able to see your ticket too. Will they be able to see? No, they'll not be. Correct? So in this particular case, what is going to happen in this particular case, because they are not going, any other colleague of yours are not going to be able to view your incident, it becomes a trouble for you. You can't call service desk every time asking them to say, okay, which field has been updated. Obviously, they are not going to do that for you. So in this particular case, it could have been better if you would have given access to a friend of yours, a colleague of yours, manager, whatever the case may be. So they are also able to view the update on your ticket, and that's what you were looking for, correct? How is that doable? For that to do, what we can do is we can add the people name in the watch list. So the people whose name has been added in the watch list, they will even be able to see their ticket over here in this case. So in this particular case, Vinisha would have asked maybe Rahul or Naresh name to be added over there while ticket getting created, so that she can seek help of these guys, as in these guys are also able to see updates happening on the incident, as in these guys are also able to see now Vinisha's incident because they are added in the watch list. So watch list are the people who are not the caller, not the open by seven group members. Still, they are able to see the ticket back because their name has been added in the watch list. And from the notification, from the email point of service notice, said that whosoever's name is there in the watch list, they will be notified when any update happens on the ticket. Are we good till here? Is it making sense clear, guys?
Yep.
Then what is work notes list? As the field says, work notes list means whosoever's name I added in the work notes, they will be notified only when the work notes field changes. They will not be notified when any other field changes, rather only notified when the work notes field changes over here in this case.
Right. So only one question.
Mm-hmm.
On a generic basis, do we add a person's manager to the watch list by default? Is it a generic practice or like, I mean,
it is,
I'm
it is
just
not
asking
default.
In practice. Okay. It,
no, it
not
is not
needed.
A default.
Okay.
So making sense over here, guys? Any query till here?
No questions. All good. Yeah.
Okay. So now the next thing which we need to understand over here in this case is what? The next thing which we need to understand over here in this case is how is the life cycle of the incident going to work on? So I've seen, shown you the fields. Let's proceed further. Whenever we do update, it takes us to the previous screen. I still want to continue working on this incident. So, but at the same time, I even want to save the data. So in that case, I'll do a right click on the header and I'll click on save. When I do so, you can see system saved that data for me. It did make the database update, but still kept me on the same page. So the difference between the save button and the update button is that both are obviously doing the server transaction. But the difference between the two is when I do a save, it keeps me still on the same page. When I do an update, it takes me to the list view of the table. That's the default behavior. That is, if you still want to continue working on the record, obviously your preference will be a right-click save. Now, let's see the life cycle of this particular record. So once a technician, let's say in this case, Pavni, once technician finds the fix of this particular record, what will the step the technician will take? Within ServiceNow, guys, state, obviously, in this case, we are talking about the state. Within ServiceNow, close is very critical. That is, in ServiceNow, when the moment the ticket is closed, let's say, for example, in this case, if I move the incident to closed, then only ServiceNow developer, people like us, that is the super user, only we will be able to see the tickets. So in this case, we should not, as in, because of this reasoning, at any given point in time, a technician should not go ahead in the instance perspective, and a technician should never be closing the incident. Why? Because what if a caller is not satisfied with the resolution provided? He or she may want to make some changes over there. Correct? He or she may want to ask technician for some other help. The caller is not happy. The caller wants some design change or the behavior in that particular case, maybe. So in such a particular case, how it will work, that becomes a question. Correct. So what do we need to understand over here in this case is, we need to understand over here in this case is, at any given point in time, for that particular reasoning to give you the option to the caller to reject the solutioning, what do we need to make sense over here in this case? So we need to understand over here in this given case that whenever we are doing the setup or the configuration, one thing we need to understand is that whenever technician finds the solution or the fix of the issue, The technician will not close the ticket, rather technician will just resolve the ticket. So that at a later, sorry, someone was saying something, please go ahead.
Let's continue.
So that's at any given point in time, whenever the technician finds a solution, we are asking technician not to close the ticket, rather resolve the ticket. So the benefit will be when the ticket is in resolved state, if end user is not happy, end user can easily go ahead and reject the solutioning over there provided. Okay. So let's
So one question. There is also one more state you call work in progress, right?
So work in progress is nothing but it is equivalent to active. So if you will check in your system, click on the drop down.
Okay.
So can you see over there new is there and then work in progress is there, correct?
Yes, got it. I mean, we don't need to keep it. The only state which is important is resolved, right? Resolved,
yep.
And then closed. Okay, cool.
Yep. So if you can check it out over
there,
here
is no reason. Case. There is no reason to keep a ticket in work in progress state for a long time.
Can't tell me. Do you have a token value as active over there in your state choice? Do you have active?
Yes.
So what does active means? I told you the moment the ticket is assigned to, the moment assigned to is populated, then the ticket becomes active. Correct.
Right.
But when the assigned to person starts working on the ticket, he or she will have the responsibility of changing the state to work in progress. That's what work in progress means.
Got it.
Means now
got
the person is accepting that I am starting the work over here.
Okay. So, got it. Once the person is done working on the ticket, he will keep it in resolve. Okay.
Correct.
Got
so
it.
Once the
yeah.
person
we can move on.
Tries to provide the solution, once the person has found the fix of the solution, in that case, the person will click on the button over here located called resolve incident. Let's check out that. How does it work? So when I click on this one, you can see the page is not refreshing, correct? Nothing is happening as such. Only the state got changed. But if the page on click of a certain button has not refreshed, means your current page is having some mandatory fields which are not populated and because of which system is not letting you navigate any further. So you can check it out over here. Let's check it. Where is the field mandatory located? So if I scroll down. You can see, for example, system is giving me the error over here. It says comments are required when resolving an incident. So obviously, when me as a technician, when I'm resolving, means when I'm fixing the issue, I must provide in the additional comment what is the fix which I did. Not from technical aspect, guys. Never ever to the customer give the technical aspect of the solution. Just keep it simple for them. I can say, for example, replaced your keyboard obviously I'll never say to the end user what was the technical background or technical history of the issue. Never say that to the end user because they don't know the technicality for sure. So this is the additional comment if I'm entering. Now if I try to resolve incident again, still the system is throwing me some error saying close notes, close quotes are mandatory. Let's check it out. Where are those located? You can see over here it is not within ServiceNow, guys. These tabs are called section. So note is a section, related record is section, close information as section. So when I say these are section, these are still showing you fields of the same table only. We have created the section just to make the form look better, just to make segregation on the form, no other reasoning involved. Okay. So the behavior of the fields are still the same. Only we have structured it up over here in this case to achieve what? Only we have structured it up over here in this case to make the form look better. Make sense?
Yes.
Okay. So now when I come over here in this particular one app, when I see the designing over here in this case is first thing first is when I'm making the selection over here, where is my mandatory field located? So if a section is containing a mandatory field which needs to be filled in, you will see that time the section name ends with a star, that is the asterisk mark. Where can I see that? I can see it up over here in this case in the closer information section. There is a star means this section has some mandatory field which needs to be populated for me to proceed further. Let me select, let's say, whatever the close code, maybe the technician will do the selection of that and then put the comments on that, there is a close notes on that, and click on resolve incident. So now when a technician clicks on that, you can see, yes, it did direct me to some other page, it did refresh the previous page, means now the resolution has happened. So now if you can open the incident again, you will see, yes, the ticket has been moved to the resolved state. Out of the box, emails are configured in such a way that the moment a ticket state changes to resolved, caller is sent an email so that the caller is aware that his or her issue has been fixed. Okay, so when the caller over here in this particular case, whenever we are doing the configuration over here in this particular case, what do we need to understand? We do need to understand over here in this case that if a caller comes back to the ticket, now he was aware ticket got resolved, he came over here to have a look. When a caller comes over here to the incident level, he checks it out, the ticket is resolved. He goes down and checks it out. Okay, what comments was given? He had a look. If he is happy, okay, good to go. When a caller will log in actually over here, guys, they will get even another two set of buttons on the form. One will be reading close, one will be reading your reopen. Here right now I'm not the caller, so I'm not getting those buttons over here. So one will be close, one will be reopen. So if the caller is happy with the solution, he will go ahead and close the ticket. I don't have button, rather I'm going to use the state to close the ticket. But if the caller is not happy, he or she will click on reopen. Reopen will do nothing, but it will change the state value again back to your active or work in progress. I don't remember any of those being selection, so you can have a look into that. So it will change it back to active or work in progress, so that now we are asking the end user, sorry, we are asking the technician, the assigned to person, again to work on the ticket because the solution provided was not satisfactory from the user, from the end user perspective. Does that make sense over here? Are we good to hear, guys? The life cycle of incident, are we good to?
Yes, we are good.
So that's about the incident life cycle. Now, the next application which I wanted to start up was what? The next application which I wanted to talk about is understanding a problem application. Anyone any idea, guys? What is a problem? When do we create a problem? If not, can any one of you, in fact, all three of you, can you have a look into this? Just read out the definition and let me know what understanding you get from it.
I understood that it's like a group of incidents are repeatedly created on a particular problem. If a particular error arises, so there's a problem.
Type. So problem means nothing but repeated incidents of getting created, incidents, multiple incidents of getting created. That's the case over here in this case. Correct? That is just a scenario again over here to understand it better. Let's say we go ahead in the instance perspective and suppose maybe all four of us, we are working in a secured bay project. And today when we try to enter the secured bay, when we try to, you know, punch in our ID card, let's say that's the process which we are entering. We punch in our ID card, it validates whether I'm authorized person or not, and lets me enter the project. Today, when I punch in my ID card, it didn't let me in. What will I do? I'll raise the incident because something is broken for me. Let's just suppose the same thing happened with all four of us. We don't know whether the issue is with our ID card or whether the issue is with the punching machine. So obviously, all four of us are going to end up creating incident. Now let's think about from a technical perspective. Let's say suppose Srinivas is the technician in this case. So right now in this case, for the similar kind of issue, now Srinivas is having four incidents assigned to him. But obviously because he's technician, he does know that the issues are related. So that's why what Srinivas will do is instead of updating the same ticket, instead of updating all the four tickets again and again with any of his finding, it will be a waste of time. If he finds anything, he'll have to update ticket A, B, C, and D. So it's a waste of time for him. So what he could have done better, the thing he could have done better is, instead he could have created a problem record for himself. So the benefit is, now if a problem record is created by the technician, the benefit will be what? When a problem record is created by the technician will not have to work on the individual incident. Rather, he will work directly on the problem record. So his time will not be wasted. Agree on that or not, guys?
Yes, it will save a lot of time.
Yeah, so that's why a problem is created when incidents of multiple when incidents of the similar kind are created multiple times. In that particular case, a technician will end up creating a problem and start working on problem rather working on the individual incident, because it has got a technicality involved. Obviously, end user will not be able to understand. They can see the description and relate a little bit, but they can't be 100% sure whether the issues are of the same kind or not. So that's why the option to create problem out of the incident, we are giving it only to the technician. Only a technician should be able to create problem. End user will not have the option to do that. Are we good so far?
Yes.
Okay. So if not any query, I'll wrap it up over here, guys. So any query till this understanding, I will go to with this, whatever we have covered so far. Or you want me to clarify on any of these, whatever we have seen till here? Naresh, good for you too?
Yeah. From my side, I'm good for now. Yep.
Okay, I'll talk about knowledge at the time of knowledge application. So I'll talk about. So we'll wrap it up over here, guys. We'll catch up tomorrow to proceed further. Thanks a lot. Bye bye.
Sure. Thank you.